Hello, I'm Maggie from the Hunters Point Library. A few notices before we begin. Enjoy unlimited browsing and open seating at many of our libraries without time limits. All available QPBO locations have opened as of Monday, July 12th. To learn more, see our virtual program calendar, access digital services, or get a library card, visit queenslibrary.org. Summer reading, Reading Takes You Everywhere, continues this month as we launch our participation raffle. All year long, QPBO marks its 125th anniversary. Visit queenslibrary.org for book lists, resources, and more. We do want to mention that this is one of many and that this program series for the Hunters Point Environmental Education Center will be happening periodically on Saturdays at 2 p.m. on YouTube Live. Our next program is Tower, Framing Personal Experiences with Climate Change on August 7th at 2 p.m. So check the comments as we'll be putting in the links for these events so you can set a reminder. These programs are made possible by the Newtown Creek Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by City Parks Foundation, and funded by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. Now, for today's program, we are joined by Lisa Bloodgood from the Newtown Creek Alliance and Jay Holmes from the American Museum of Natural History. As we explore some of the pollinators in our neighborhood and learn why they are integral to our making our beautiful communities possible. If you have any questions for Lisa or Jay, please write them in the live chat as we will have an audience Q&A at the end of this session. Now we will present a video by Lisa and Jay, and following the video, there will be a discussion. So hold on please as I pull up the video.
I'm Lisa Bloodgood with Newtown Creek Alliance. We're here at Kingsland Wildflowers.
And hi, my name is Jay Holmes. Tagging along, gonna be looking for some pollinators out here. It looks great.
Fantastic. Kingsland Wildflowers was built starting in 2016 through a community benefits agreement out of the ExxonMobil oil spill settlement, which the oil spill is right around the corner from where we're standing. And it wasn't one oil spill, but one that took place over many decades, starting maybe in the 1860s through the 1960s. Somewhere in there is when the oil spills, cumulative oil spills, happened. And the settlement money was $19.5 million that came to the community of Greenpoint to make amends for that oil spill. And so some of that money came here to build this green roof. It was built by a green roof company called Alive Structures, and the partners at the time and still to this day are Broadway Stages. They own this building and they contributed to the build out of this green roof. Newtown Creek Alliance, my organization, and New York City Audubon was an original partner in that grant. And so we built this green roof here in this industrial area as a way to not only create something beautiful that's open to the public for educational events, for fun events, and for all kinds of things, really, but it's also important habitat to our native pollinators. Most of the plants up here are native to the Northeast. Some are native to the Southwest, but they just do so well on a green roof, so they're here with us. And of course, the benefits of stormwater capture. So these rooftops and these meadows hold quite a bit of water when it's raining. So during the storms that we had last night, these roofs were able to keep a lot of water out of the combined sewer system, which is benefiting our local waterways. So it's multiple benefits. You have the habitat, you have the stormwater capture, and these vegetated areas keep temperatures cooler. So this roof is significantly cooler than many of the unvegetated surrounding roofs. So benefit after benefit is layered on when you have something like this. And then if you look over here, we have so many little bumblebees holding on to this goldenrod, waiting out the storm. You can see they're all soaking wet and they're holding on. And as soon as things dry up a little bit, they'll be back buzzing around, collecting nectar and pollen.
How do we get started looking for pollinators? The easiest thing to do is to just get outside and start looking. And don't worry too much about how am I going to figure out what I'm looking at, all that kind of stuff. Just get out and explore first and start to notice different things. And then you might, after exploring a little bit, want to get some help figuring out what you're looking at. And there's lots of different ways to get that kind of help these days. There are lots of different kinds of identification guides and books. I've been using these for years. Peterson's Insect Guide and National Wildlife Federation puts out a guide. I like both of these. These are all insects. And so there's sections on beetles and sections on dragonflies, and eventually you'll get into some bees and wasps, okay? And there's pictures in there. Some are color, some are black and white to help you sort of figure out what you're looking at. Other guides will use photographs, but it's the same kind of thing. All the beetles are together and all the bees are together. And then you sort of compare and see which one looks closest to what you're looking at. Those are big books to carry around. Sometimes you don't want to carry around so much. And there are smaller guides that are specific to certain groups. Like this one is bees of Eastern North America. And so it's just a few fold out pages of the major bee types or groups that we have here. And you might think bees, oh, honeybees, blah, 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 bumblebees. There's like three different kinds of bees. No, there's thousands. And so a flyer like this will organize it by a couple of different groups. There's probably about eight different groups in here. There's bees that make little burrows in the ground. There's bees that will lay their eggs in a hollow stem of a plant or a tree trunk or something like that. And these bumblebees that we're seeing clinging on for dear life, these are the males. Where are the females? The females are the ones in the nest. And that's usually in a abandoned mouse hole or some kind of hole in the ground. And so these different insects are living in different places, using different resources, and gathering pollen in different ways. And we'll try to talk about that as we go along. So we've been soaked down overnight, and so these guys are all wet. The bumblebees, their bodies are dark colored. And when the bristles on their body get wet, they sort of mat down against the body. And so you see the body color coming through more, so they look very dark. And as these guys are combing and drying themselves off in the breeze, you're seeing the bristles sort of fluff up, and you see the yellow color of some of those bristles more. The flower parts on the milkweed are really cool. There's little nectaries, little spots where the nectar is down inside there, and the pollen isn't loose and a bunch of little grains. It's kind of in little packets or bundles. And it sticks to the feet sometimes of insects that land on the flower, and then they carry it off to visit another plant and spread the pollen around. So it's a pretty cool flower structure when you look closely at it there.
So now we've left Kingsland Wildflowers and we are about a 2-minute walk to the entrance of the Newtown Creek Nature Walk. And this is the final section, phase three, if you will, that just opened a couple months ago, and it follows along the waterfront of Newtown Creek, and it's a phenomenal design, designed by actually artist George Trakas, and this has been in the works for more than 20 years, and it finally opened, and it's absolutely stunningly beautiful, and it brings you through deep time and explores water management systems and so much more. But there's a lot of really beautiful and productive native plants here. You can see we've got the Joe Pieweed is flowering right now. So we'll see what we can find as we explore the nature walk. Let's take the pseudo stream bed.
Oh, it's a spider.
Oh yeah, I got a spider on here too. We got a jumping spider.
Yes.
Look at that. Not quite an insect, but still.
Predator.
And jumping spiders are so cool. They have these really powerful eyes, and they don't make webs, but they'll just jump on and grab their prey. Blazing stars.
Oh, there's a grasshopper down in there.
Another small little grasshopper.
Yeah,
look
really.
At that.
Oh, here's a little tiny bee.
Yep.
And there's a grasshopper on the same flower head. Oh. Wow. Oh, there's a couple of bees. Oh, here he is on the coneflower. It's visible.
They're so small, they're often easy to miss,
yeah,
or mistake for a fly.
Yeah.
It's a geometer. It's an inchworm caterpillar. Right there. So this will grow up to be a moth of some kind. And this is a wonderful snack for a little bird. And look at, oh, its little inchworm body. Just the best.
So we're seeing a slightly different bumblebee here, or another species. A brown belted. I guess this is where all the coneflower is. Maybe they'll come back. But what you look for is you look on the abdomen, and it's mostly black, and up towards the head, the front end of the abdomen, on the common eastern, there's like two little yellow spots on the first segment. And the brown belted, that first segment's all yellowish sort of color, and the second segment is a little bit of golden brown to yellow kind of color, so it's got coloration on the second segment. So those are things that you look for. Is that this is like a big, restaurant. Everybody's coming in here to get their food. And it's a lure. It's attracting insects in for the food. And then other insects are here to interact with the other insects that are coming in for the food. So there are some that are parasites, and they'll lay eggs on bees or wasps or other things that are coming in. And this particular fly is looking rather suspicious. He's not very interested in the flower. He's looking out away from the flower. And that's a sign that he's not so interested maybe in nectar or pollen, but more maybe interested in somebody who's coming to visit. And there are flies that will parasitize bees. And not exactly sure on that species there, but we'll keep an eye out. If I see any of the thick-headed flies, we'll point those out.
Well, something that's just fantastic about the nature walk is its acknowledgement of deep time. And, you know, this isn't a plant, and it certainly isn't a pollinator, but this stone is, I think, 3.5 billion with a B, billion years old. Some of the oldest stones on Earth. This section is by far my favorite because these are fossilized tree stumps, and these stones here and the pavers are brachiopods.
Nice.
So these came from upstate New York. Really, really beautiful stuff. It seems to go back in time and all related to human culture, evolution, what life is made of, all kinds of things. And each of these little sections look like a boat.
A little boat, yeah.
This segment towards, you know, the other entrance opened in 2007. So quite the time lapse.
Yeah.
And you can tell some of these plants are really kind of big.
Yeah. These guys tend to gather a little bit of nectar from the flowers. He buzzed off. Some flower forms are these crowns of flowers, umbel, and the insects will sort of walk around all that flat surface and visit each flower, get a little bit of nectar, and you can see that anthers, the part of the flower with the pollen on it, sticking up there. So as they're walking around, they're getting all dusted with pollen on their undersides, and moving that between plants. There's a little bee climbing up that flower, gathering a little bit of pollen. You can see pollen on the legs. The hind legs on this one are kind of dusted yellow. This is another one of those little furrow bees probably. And it's climbing up each one of those flowers. These little balls of many flowers. The bees visit each one as they go around. So that's a little native bee. Yeah, it's up there in the sunshine. It's probably a little warmer up there. There is one western honeybee up on a flower cluster up there. We've seen quite a few.
There's one right there.
Yep, down close. It's got a little bit of pollen on the legs so far this morning. Here's a little hoverfly coming in. So a lot of our native bees don't produce tons of honey like the honeybee does. They are gathering pollen and they'll use a little bit of nectar to make that pollen into like a paste ball, and they feed that to their young. The pollen is a good protein source for the developing young, and the adults are mostly feeding on nectar for themselves. That wasp scattered the bumblebees. The wasps are in here gathering nectar too, and they also might be hunting for food items for their young. Wasps feed their young other animals mostly. They're very specialized, many of them. Some just eat or just gather spiders for their young. You may have heard about cicada killer wasps. They just gather cicadas. And others gather caterpillars. They can be a very good thing to have around your garden because they'll control some plant pests.
Right.
And they're not bothering the bees. They're just gathering some nectar and looking for maybe caterpillars or other things. And they're pretty crazy architects too. Some of them are using mud to make a nest, and others plant pulp, making paper. Pretty cool. Nest in the ground some solitary bees, and they're burrows look kind of like a little ant nest, mm-hmm. only the hole is very round and a little bigger, smaller than the diameter of a pencil, but bigger than what you'd see in a normal ant hill.
Yeah.
Ant hole. And so, and you can watch, and you'll, and maybe if they're active, they're probably going in and out of there once every 10, 15 minutes, something like that.
Yeah.
And sometimes they're digging out, like after a rain like this, there's probably some dirt that got knocked down in the hole, so they're gonna need to clean up a little bit. So if you find something that looks promising, hang out, and you might see them backing up and pushing dirt with their hind legs out of the hole. And it's kind of cool to watch because they're distracted and busy, so you can just see what they're up to.
So it's all about watching, waiting, being patient.
Yeah. Get in a comfortable position.
Right.
And relax.
Relax and enjoy the activity. So we just left the nature walk, the Newtown Creek Nature Walk, and we're about 2 minutes from the entrance of phase one. And here we are on Page Avenue, where Newtown Creek Alliance for the last 3 years has been working on building out a pollinator pathway. And a pollinator pathway is really just a planted area that connects maybe park to park or habitat to habitat. And so again, we're in an industrial area. Right behind these brick walls is fossil fuel storage. And here we have what's the beginning, first year really, of a native wildflower meadow. We'll just call it an urban meadow because this isn't really how native meadows get going. And so we planted all of these plants that you're looking at now just a couple of weeks ago, and they're doing pretty good. They're going to fill out more as time goes by. And right here is what we planted last year in the pandemic, and it's looking really lush.
This is a wool carder, a wool carder bee. When you card wool, it means you're like combing it. And these guys will gather fuzz off of certain kinds of plants, like mullein has a very fuzzy surface on the leaf. And these guys will rake it with their legs and use that as a nest material. And they can be really territorial. The males will sort of stake out an area and chase anything, thinking it's a female. And they won't bother humans, you know, you can get in there, and they might at first move towards you because they think you're like a female bee, but then they'll realize it and you're not and back off. You can see them sitting over there now on the leaf. They will warm up their body. The warmer they are, the faster they get. And the male wants to be really fast to catch females. And so they'll sun themselves like that. Oh, now, what do you notice about this bumblebee?
Well, he's got no yellow.
No yellow. All
pretty small.
Yep.
And his legs look white.
Yep. It's a really different coloration from the other guys that are out here. These mostly eastern, common eastern bumblebee. And this guy, if he turns around, we might see some little white spots on his back end. I'm not seeing them. Sometimes they're sort of curved under. That guy's really patient. Usually these guys are flying like crazy, and it's partly because of the rain and the cool weather that we've had. Sometimes I have so much trouble photographing these guys because they're not sitting still at all. But one advantage of having a cold night is that things are slower. Oh man, there is an excellent bee mimicking fly on the sundew down there. That thing way down there is a fly, and it has black and yellow stripes and everything. Looks like a bee.
And
he's maybe even closer. Oh, here he is. So one of the one of the hoverflies. There's a whole bunch of different species of these guys. And this is when I try to get my camera ready and I zoom in to halfway on my camera, and then I try to get nice and close and it helps me focus. I tap my screen to focus. Ooh, boy, and it went crazy in the wind. Try to get a good iNaturalist photo for ID. So the pattern on the abdomen, the back end of them, is very helpful in identifying And then this guy right here is a brown belted bumblebee. There's a little on the back end of him there. There's a white up on the front. And then right behind that, it's kind of a golden brown color. And that's the identifying characteristic. And it's interesting. You'll see variation in size of bees of the same species. Anything that has wings on it is an adult. It's not going to get any bigger than it is when you see it. That's true of a butterfly, a bee, any insect. When it has wings, that's the adult. And because their skeleton is on the outside of their body, they're not going to grow anymore after that point. Yeah, a monarch flyby. Oh, right here on the... Nice. So cool, another butterfly pollinator visiting flowers.
Well, we've made it to the Manhattan Avenue Street End Park and the final stop along our pollinator pathway walk. And what can I say? So we have Newtown Creek just beyond and the mouth of the creek where it meets the East River just to the west here. And the community of Greenpoint to my right. You just go down Manhattan Avenue and you're in the heart of it. And what we've done is we've walked along maybe about a mile in total from Kingsland Wildflowers to the Newtown Creek Nature Walk to the Page Avenue Pathway and here to the Manhattan Avenue Street End Park. And all of these places are open to the public. Come and visit Kingsland Wildflowers. So we have very often we have events and you're welcome to join us. July 31st, we're having a Kingsland Wildflowers Festival. So it's a great opportunity to bring your family, your friends, come and explore the roofs and have some fun with us. And the Nature Walk is open from dawn till dusk. And this is open all the time. So please come and explore the plants and our pollinators. And this is a great time of year to do it too, because we're in July and so many things are in full bloom.
Is this a mountain mint? What
yeah,
is this guy?
This is mountain mint.
Okay, this carpet of nectar producers. And right in here, there's a little bee that's deeply buried inside there. Very focused on getting some nectar, I think. And this is a leaf cutter bee. And when we saw the bumblebees, they had little balls of pollen stuck to their hind legs. And these guys gather the pollen on the underside of the back section of their body, their abdomen. And I don't know if you can see, there's kind of a, it's light colored pollen against a light colored flower, so it's hard to see. But she's buried down in there. I hope she didn't get grabbed by a crab spider. No, look, she's definitely drinking in there. We talked earlier about some spiders hanging out in the flower heads. And sometimes they can grab a bee when it sticks its head in there. Their genus is Megachile, the big mouth. Because they have pretty big jaws that they use to snip leaves in little circles and use that to build their nest. Their nest is usually, it's a solitary bee, so a single female will be working in a hole in a tree, for example, and starting at the back makes a little chamber with those circles of leaf, and then puts a little ball of pollen and a little nectar in there and lays an egg on it, And then she seals it up with a little piece of leaf and does a new chamber. And she just keeps doing that until she's filled a little tunnel that some other insect made in the tree. And then next spring, those will all hatch out. And she can control whether the offspring is going to be male or female. And so deep inside the hole, she'll lay female eggs first. And then when she gets close to the end of the hole, she'll start laying male eggs. So in the spring, the ones that are close to the opening are males, they hatch first and they come out. And they'll hang out around other nests. And as the later ones emerge, they are females. And so they'll mate. So the males are out waiting. And the females come out later. So it's this one right here. Okay. She's a little leaf cutter bee gathering nectar after.
And I'm so happy to be here today because I didn't get to come along when you were filming all of that. Wow, you got lots of great pollinators and all kinds of other cool stuff in there. I wonder if a lot of people, though, are kind of saying, yikes, look at those bees. And you guys were like, had your hands right down next to them. Were you not afraid?
No, Lynn, we are clearly not afraid. And most of the time, there's really nothing to be afraid of. Unless we came up on a hive of honeybees and we're, you know, really getting into it. I have been working with plants and insects for a great many years, and I think I was only stung once. Uh-huh. And it wasn't bad at all. It was just like a little pinch. And it was because I also stumbled upon a bumblebee nest buried in the grasses. I didn't see it. And they chased me away real fast.
Yeah, that's been my experience too. We mentioned that there are thousands of different species of bees around, and we often think of the honeybees, which have these big, huge hives with thousands of bees in there, and all that valuable honey that they are concerned about protecting, as well as their young. But most bees are solitary bees. They live by themselves, and so their hives are just themselves. And it doesn't make sense for that one bee to go and get itself killed chasing me off from its only nest. And so they generally leave you alone. It's sort of an evolutionary thing, the social bees and wasps versus the solitary ones. And most of them are solitary. And so you get right up close, taking pictures. It's a lot of fun.
And isn't it true, Jay, that most of the male species, the males don't even have stingers?
Yeah. So the thing that is the stinger is the thing that is used to lay eggs. It's an ovipositor, it's called. And so only females lay eggs. So only females can sting. And that's true of bees and wasps. For most of the bees, I had one here someplace. Maybe I'll find it later. The males have a white dot in the middle of their face. And so you can tell which ones are males, especially the big carpenter bees, which are our biggest bees, like this guy here. I don't know if I can get it close to the camera. This one's a female, no white dot. I had a male around here someplace. Oh, see if I can find it later.
Maybe he'll show up soon.
Yeah, it buzzed around here somewhere.
I hope that that is relieves a lot of people's fears. I remember somebody commenting about some landscaping we were doing around our building, and there were some parents of young kids, and I understand how parents are. As a parent myself, they were hesitant to want to invite pollinators in with the plantings because they were afraid that their children might get stung. But those, I think you're right. Those bees are not looking for us. And a few weeks ago, our good friend Christina Delfico was talking about her three bees of be aware and be back. And oh my goodness, I've forgotten what the third one was. but appreciate them. And they probably are not going to, most likely not going to be any harm to you.
Right. That's so true. But it's also a natural response. You know, we have evolved as humans to be cautious around insects for good reason, because, you know, some can kill you, not our pollinators, that's for sure. But, oh, that was that the white spot you were showing us?
Yeah, that was on the
white
spot.
Oh, let's see that.
Oh, wow.
Where my camera is. So you can see he's got a little white dot. That's the carpenter bee, the same one as the all black face that I showed you a second ago. So
it's like a little mustache.
Yeah, really. It's like a little.
That's great.
Yeah.
Well, shall I we think share? You each had some specimens to show us. Yeah, let's go.
The video wrapped up, we were talking about the little leaf cutter bee. And so, whoops, I didn't want to do that. I want to click on this. And so I have a little camera here. I'm going to try to show a close-up of a couple of things. So this is a little leaf cutter bee. When scientists collect specimens, we put the insects on pins. And really, the pin is a handle. So we don't touch the specimen when we want to look at it. We can just use the pin. The insects are dry and they're very delicate. If I touch the antennae or the legs on this guy, they'll just fall off. So I use the pin. And if we look at the back side of this guy, you can see those bristles sticking out of the underside of the abdomen. And oftentimes we hear about bees collecting pollen on their legs. It depends on the bee. The leaf cutter bees they collect the pollen on the underside, on those big long bristles. And that's what that bee was doing that we were watching just at the end of the video. And I think that Lisa has something else connected to the leaf cutter bee.
I do. I love the leaf cutter bees. They are so fun to watch. And so I have, I'm at my house right now. We have a small little patio with some plants, and including a small red maple in a pot. And there's only a few leaves on this maple tree, but the leaf cutter bees that are nearby have really gone to town collecting little pieces of these leaves to build their nests. And so they do, I'll show this one because it's a little less eaten, but they'll take these, they'll cut these circles, they're perfect little circles, and then they'll do these ovals, kind of like more of like an oblong shape. And the oval parts are like, they'll wrap around, and then the circles are the cap and the bottom. And they make this almost like pill-sized and pill-shaped nest where they'll deposit their, like the pollen and nectar paste. And then the egg that, you know, Jay was talking about in the video, they make these and they bury them in their burrows, and they're just a lot of fun to watch. So if you were to come over to my house and sit with me on my deck, we could watch the leaf cutter bees not only gathering the pollen and the nectar from the plants, the flowering plants, but also coming and cutting out these little shapes, perfect little shapes, and then holding them in their big jaws, their megachile mouth, and flying away with them and bringing them down into those nests. So if you see a leaf that has this kind of cutout shape, they're not being eaten. Those are home to the next generation of leaf cutter bees.
I have seen that, and it's fascinating. I saw a whole bunch of leaves that had been had all those little circles cut out in City Hall Park a few years ago. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's all around town. I can show you the mouth parts of the leaf cutter bee, so you can sort of see their scissors here. Go back to that camera. I think it's this one. Yep, that's the one. Get my screen in order here. So we were looking at the back end, and now we can look at the front end, and you can see almost like the, it's like a little beak on the bottom of his face there, or her face. And they have little scissors. And bee mouth parts are kind of interesting. These are the scissors, and inside, they've got to be able to gather honey and nectar, right? Nectar. This is a wasp, and bees and wasps are kind of related, and you can notice that the jaws on this wasp are huge. Jaws are, wasps are hunters, and they're stinging their prey and chewing them up, and this guy's also chewing up trees to make paper, to make a wasp nest. So wasps have that kind of a mouth. And then bees, let's see, got a couple here. Let's go with this guy here. They have those little jaws, but then they also have sort of folded up under their face, this tongue arrangement. And you can sort of see three long things coming out of the bottom of the face here. There's two on the sides that are sort of rigid, like a sheath kind of a thing. And then in the middle, there's a long tongue that they stick into the flower. And it's kind of feathery on the end, like a little duster or kind of like a sponge. It's got lots of little nooks and crannies in there for the nectar to kind of stick to the tongue. And it uses that to slurp up the nectar out of the flower. This is a little Eastern bumblebee. And you can see this guy has the pollen stuck on his leg right there. You see that big brown glob? Mm-hmm. So bumblebees collect the nectar on their legs.
And that was just, that's a female, right? Because the males don't collect pollen to bring back. So if you don't see a pollen pack on the legs, it most likely is a male. Is that right also?
Yep.
Very cool.
The males will be going around collecting nectar to feed themselves and keep themselves going with lots of energy. And the females will be doing that and also collecting nectar and pollen for their offspring.
Yep. Fantastic. Yeah. It's not every day you get to see a close-up of a bee's tongue. So thanks for sharing that. Really impressive.
It's been around for a while. I don't collect so many. The ones that I have in the box here are from 2014, 2016, so they're pretty old. I get to use them for a long time.
Yeah, wow. They're holding up really well. I guess maybe this might be a good time to show some of the flower samples that I have, because just keeping that bee's tongue in your mind, I have this this little guy, which was also in our video. It was the really big, tall purple stalks, Agaste funiculum, or I'm forgetting the common name. Anis hyssop, I think, is what it is. But so it looks like, you know, from afar, maybe you're thinking this whole thing is the flower, but it's actually, and I have a magnifying glass, which makes this super fun, if I can line it up right. But you can see there, it's a series of tubular flowers. Oh, everything is reversed. It's hard to do things backwards. So you see, you've got all these very small flowers that are tubular in shape, and you can see the little pollen carrying anthers. This is surprisingly more challenging than you would think. You can see the anthers sticking out of the flower, and so when the bee kind of pulls in and goes for the nectar, it will be dusted with that pollen. And if you think about it, you know, that bee's tongue is perfectly suited and adapted to get to the base of that tubular flower where the nectar is. And there are long tongue bees and short tongue bees. And so you can imagine that some flowers like the Monarda or the bergamot, the wild bergamot that we were seeing in the video, they have really long tubes. And so maybe a short tongue bee wouldn't be able to reach the nectar that a long tongue bee could reach, or you know, you saw the proboscis of the monarch butterfly, also would definitely be long enough to reach the nectar sources in a tubular flower like this. And you know, hummingbirds are not insects, but they do love the flower's nectar and they do also pollinate. So it's possible, I'm not totally sure, but if a hummingbird would like the agashte, but certainly would like some of those other tubular flowers. So this one is a lot of fun. It smells like licorice. It's a real beautiful addition to your garden and attracts a ton of bees. I watch this also on my deck here, and everything from, you know, those tiny little bees that are no bigger than my tip of my pinky nail, all the way to the big common bumblebees, really love this plant.
Uh-huh. Is that in the mint family? I know there's so many plants in the mint family.
It is. And actually, that's a great question because it's got this telltale characteristic. Ooh, let me see. Can I do this again? Or can you even see it? But the stem is square. And so anything in the mint family is going to have a square stem, but not all square stems are in the mint family. So that, this is ridiculous.
I have a very hard time with that too.
Good. I've been doing the same thing here. You mentioned the variety of bees. I have a little box here that I'll see if I can show on the screen.
Wow.
So, and again, this is going to be like, which way is left and right? The ones over on this side are all different kinds of bees. And you can see there's quite a range in size. Some are green, some are, you know, different combinations of yellow and black. And we saw one that was just about all black. That was a longhorn bee because it has really long antennae on it. And some of them have shorter antennae. So there's a lot of variety there. And on this side, these guys are all not bees. These bottom two are flies. And the top two are wasps. And so sometimes when you're outdoors, you might look at something and initially say, oh, a bee. But it might not be a bee. It might be something else. And the quickest way to sort of tell the difference for me is that flies, this side, flies have really big eyes and kind of small antennae usually. And they just have one pair of wings. They have one wing on each side. And bees and wasps have kind of smaller eyes relative to their head and longer antennae. And they have two pairs of wings. So there's some basic differences like that that'll help you out real quick. But it's kind of neat to see these things that look like something else and think about, wonder why they might do that or come out that way. So
kind of fun. Yeah, but what's wonderful is that if you were to be anywhere where we were on our walk last week or whenever that was, if you just spend just a few minutes sitting there looking at one of these plants, you're going to see the flies and the bees and the wasps. And so you can kind of take the time to say, oh, there's the big eyes of the flies, and oh, there's the four wings of the bees, and you can kind of really, just taking a few minutes, you can really start to see the differences. Yeah. And then you can be an expert for all your friends.
I'm going to put you on the spot, Jay. Do you by chance have a hoverfly specimen?
Ooh. Actually, yes.
Yay. Those are so cool.
There's many different kinds of hoverflies.
Talk about something looking like a bee.
Right.
Well, at least some of them.
Yeah. I got tangled up in the orchid here. Let me see. I'm going to get a couple for you. Just a second here.
And hoverflies are also commonly called flower flies. I don't know if those are just interchangeable common names or if there's some other distinction between the two that maybe Jay wants to talk about, if there is. but I like calling all of them flower flies because there's a different kind of human association when you're calling something a flower fly versus a hoverfly. A flower fly sounds much nicer and alludes to its relationship as a pollinator.
Yes. And you know, you were finding crab spiders. They come in the most beautiful colors matching the flowers where they hang out.
Yes.
They are so well camouflaged by their color and they're so cute.
Well, that's actually really great. I'm so glad you said that because that's because those spiders and all these insects that we're talking about, they co-evolved with their host plants. And so that's why native plants support our native pollinators and native insects and bugs in general because of that co-evolution. So it's really important that we have our native plants in the first place.
Jay, that is beautiful.
So, really
from a bug lover.
This is one of the, what I would call a hoverfly. When I think about flower flies, there's like a size range in these guys. And the ones that are bigger like this, it's about the size of a house fly. I often think of as the hoverflies. And then there's some that are like half the size of these guys and maybe a little skinnier, not so plump looking. And I often think of those as the flower flies, but they are kind of in the same larger group. And you can see how the antennae on this guy are just little things on the front of his face there. And the eyes are super
huge. Nubs. Yeah. And it's hard to see. Oh, sorry. Go ahead, Jay. Sorry.
There are some fly species that do have kind of longish antennae, more similar to a wasp or a bee, but most of them have kind of small ones. Go ahead, Lisa.
I was going to ask because from what I'm seeing in the specimen that you have, I can't tell if we see a mouth part or we're looking at a leg.
That's a leg, I think. The mouth parts are very different on a fly. They're actually tucked up inside this one. You don't see big jaws or anything. There's actually kind of a lapping tongue on this guy that's kind of up inside there. You can't really see it. I don't think I have one with the mouth part very exposed. They're all kind of tucked up in.
Great. Yeah, very different mouth parts from a fly versus a bee versus a wasp. Yeah. Really interesting.
How much time do we have? Do we have time for one microscope slide?
Sure.
With the bristles?
You get that set up and I will show another specimen that I have because this is a different kind of flower. This is getting a little droopy now, but this is a black-eyed Susan, Rebecca Herta, and this is a composite flower. And so what you're seeing is actually many different flowers in one. So let me see. Might be clearer on this one. You might be able to see there's little, so each one of those little black nubs, if you will, for lack of a better term, those are all individual little flowers with their own reproductive parts. Each one will create its own seed. And so what we think of as one single flower is actually hundreds of flowers. That's a composite flower.
It's like a bouquet.
It is. Oh, I love thinking about it that way. Yeah, so it's own bouquet and these specialized flowers at the edges, they produce these petals and those are the ray flowers. So you can almost, hopefully you can see there's a little bug climbing around on it now, but you can see, hopefully you can see the yellow specks there. Those are pollen. And those would be the anthers on those individual little flowers. So, okay. I think Jay's got his microscope set up. We can look at bristles.
Okay.
Now.
Yeah. So there was a question that we were thinking about before that was about evolution and stuff like that. Bees are relatively recently evolved and they have a special characteristic that a bunch of the other insects do not have, which make them a really great pollinator. What we're looking at here are some little bristles from a fly, and they're kind of the same as on a wasp. They're just straight. It's a very smooth hair or bristle. But if we look at the hairs on a bee, if I can find them.
Oh, the suspense is killing me.
I know, and trying to move the slide the right way is driving me crazy. There, and we got to work on the focus. Whoops. Oh, come on. Are you really excited?
I'm so excited.
Yes, me too.
Oh, goodness. Maybe this will work. I don't know why it's moving when I'm adjusting the focus. There we go. It's getting close. There. They're fuzzy.
Oh, wow.
And that's what the pollen is clinging to on the bee, this little split ends or fuzziness of the bee bristles. And that's what make them such great pollinators. And that's what set the stage for this back and forth between flowers and bees and evolution. So
that is so fantastic.
And it's fun to see the differences there and see how it makes sense from the evolution story.
And so does that, maybe there's a second to talk about specialists, right? And so, so many bees are, they're specialized. They only collect the nectar, the pollen, and specifically the pollen from certain plants. And Jay, I'm wondering if those bristles have anything to do with that specialization.
The specialization, I think, is often, you know, the shapes of the bristles and the shapes of the bodies, the sizes of the bodies, and the corresponding shifts in shapes and sizes in the flowers. And one group in particular is really great at creating all kinds of crazy shapes. I have this orchid, and this is a tropical orchid that hangs on trees. This is usually hanging in my growing spot, kind of like this. And this flower is hanging down here. And I'm going to see if I can get it under the microscope so you can see it up close. Switch to my camera as the clock is ticking.
We're going to run out of time. I think that Jay and I and Lynn, we could have this conversation all day. All day.
I come and sit and look at specimens or sit on your patio for hours. I do have one thing I'd really like to ask about while Jay's getting set up there. You know, we've been, I want to take a step back from these close-ups and think about pollinator pathway. You know, we've been hearing so much about infrastructure. Yeah. Seems like that's infrastructure for pollinators and yes, their lovers, whether it's us or flowers or the folks that eat them, the insects that eat them. And, Jay, yeah, show us that orchid. Oh my gosh, that's so cool looking.
That's beautiful.
Yeah, it's really crazy. It's got a little tongue that's sticking out there, that little dark purple tongue, and it bounces. I don't know if I can get it to bounce.
Wow. Oh, that's so cute.
And the bee goes crawling up inside there. I don't know if you can see under that little hood. And the pollen is in there in little packets. And this is another orchid packet. This is a big one that I have. This flower is like 3 inches across. And they're connected to little sticky darts. Whoa. And this is a pencil. I put the pencil in the flower and the little sticky dart with the pollen hanging on it stuck to the pencil. And so certain bees are the right size and shape to go into this particular flower and get the pollen stuck in a very specific point on their body. And these flowers and bees have evolved over time together and make a great team.
That is so great. Oh, I love that, Jay.
Yes, hi. So I don't mean to interrupt because we're at that time at just, yeah, you know, First of all, a big thank you to our presenters and for their amazing presentation. And just another big thank you to our sponsors. And please like and share this video, as this event will be available for viewing in the future. In addition, subscribe to the QPL channel to get more updates on similar upcoming programs, links for replays of upcoming events, replays of past events, and more links related to the Hunters Point Environmental Education Center are in the live chat. And I hope to see everyone on August 7th at 2 p.m. for Tower, Framing Personal Experiences with Climate Change. And thank you again, Lisa, Jay, and Lynn. It was just wonderful. I've learned so much from it. So thank you. And everyone, please enjoy the rest of your weekend. Take care.
Yes. Bye. Thank you so much, everyone.
Bye.
Bye, everybody. Bye-bye.